Good morning. If you will, stand with me. Let's start this morning with page 359. This is the day.
This is the day. This is the day that the Lord hath made. That the Lord hath made. We will rejoice. We will rejoice and be glad in it. And be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day. This is the day. This is the day that the Lord hath made, that the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it, and be glad in it. This is the day that the Lord hath made. We will rejoice and be glad in it. This is the day, this is the day.
Amen. You may be seated. If you are watching on Facebook, do not turn me off. I'm not preaching today. All right? Don't you turn me off. All right. It's good to be here this morning. As many of you know, Brother Reuben and his family are down with the flu, and so we are praying for them. Just so happened we already had scheduled Brother Mike Courtney, and I want to welcome him. He is has been here before, preached in some revival services, and so he did an outstanding job in the 8:30 service, and we're looking forward to hearing him again, and we're glad to have him today. Just a few notes on Brother Mike. He has his wife is Miss Debbie, and they have been married for 43 years and live in Rowlett, Texas. All right, he's been in the ministry for over 50 years. He's pastored for 18 of those years and has been in full-time evangelism for 19. And I will give him a large sum of money to discourage Brother Reuben from going into full-time evangelism. Amen. All right. No, he's been here before, and we're honored to have him back. And after the special music, we'd ask that you come and lead us this morning. And Brother Reuben did say that this is Brother Mike's favorite church to come preach to. Amen. So we're glad of that. But no, in the way of announcements, remember the shoebox ministry that goes on yearly, so remember that. Also, my Sunday school class, will be having a wild game supper on February the 3rd. The question was asked, why didn't we have it back in October maybe? And I said, I wanted fresh meat, right? We didn't want last year. We want some fresh stuff, so amen. February the 4th, Brother Lucas House will be here. Many of you know, remember Brother Lucas. Him and his family will be going back to Malawi on the mission field before too long, and so he's a blessing, and we look forward to hearing from him, and he'll be in both morning services on February the 4th. Tomorrow night, we'll have our men's Bible study at 7 o'clock over in the fellowship hall. Yes. Oh, really? Well, amen. Good. Thank you for letting us know that. Brother Lucas will be here tomorrow night. The ladies have a deal on February the 10th, Seeking the Face of Jesus, and you see the guest speakers there in your bulletin. That's going to be a big time. Child care is provided that night, so remember that, ladies. Also, our Antioch kids, 3 years old to fifth grade, will be singing in the morning service on February the 25th. That'll be the 10:30 service on February the 25th, and they're going to be practicing the last 10 minutes of Sunday school each week. Men's basketball Thursday nights. We started this past Thursday night. If you want to know who showed up, if you'll look after church, the ones that are walking real slow, they showed up. And now I did come and play, but I didn't even play hard enough, Philip, to even get sore. I just was kind of there. Amen. But we had a good time. If you're interested in doing that, it's nothing serious. We're not even playing full court. We're playing half court. Okay, it's 3-on-3. So. We're just having fun, and then we'll sit and kill deer for a little while, and then we'll go have a little more fun. Amen. Anything else? Did I miss anything? Today is the Sanctity of Human Life Sunday. that is recognized every year. The official date is tomorrow, the 22nd, but we as Christians celebrate it, or I don't want to say celebrate it, but we recognize it the closest Sunday to that. And so simply what that is that we as Christians, we stand together for life. We choose life, and we pray and fight against the abortions, right? And so remember that in your prayer life today and this week to pray for our nation. Even pray, we had prayer in Sunday school this morning for those that may even be contemplating that right now, some young ladies or whatever. And we also prayed for those that have chosen to do that in the past and maybe some of the things they're having to live through. And so we pray for those young ladies that have crossed that line, and we know that God can forgive and restore and bless. And so today is Sanctity of Human Life, and we just want to remember that as our church. And so we're going to have a word of prayer for that. And then we'll turn it over to our praise team. Father, thank you for allowing us to be in the Lord's house today. We pray, Lord, for our pastor and his family as they are sick. God, that you would heal them, that you would bless all those that are sick. We have so many in our church, Lord, this morning that are sick, and we pray that you would bless them. And God, remember those families that have lost loved ones. We've lost so many in the past few weeks and months, Lord. We pray for them and those that have cancer and that are struggling. God, we pray that you would touch and comfort and heal as only you can. Father, meet with us here today. Thank you for Brother Mike coming today. And Lord, it's just amazing how you knew that Brother Reuben was going to be sick, and you already set it up for Brother Mike to be here. And we know that you just work all things out for your glory. And so, Lord, bless the song service. Help us as we worship you. Bless Brother Mike. Give him the freedom in this pulpit to preach the gospel, Lord. Thank you for what you're going to do. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Let's sing page 522, When the Morning Comes.
Trials drunk on every hand, and we cannot understand all the ways that God would lead us to that blessed promised land. But he'll guide us with his eye, and we'll follow till we die. We will understand it better by and by. Tell the story, how we've overcome. We will understand it better by and by. Oft our children's plans have failed, disappointments have prevailed, and we've wandered in the darkness, heavy-hearted and alone. But we're trusting in the Lord, and according to his word, we will understand it better by and by. Hidden snares often take us unawares, and our hearts are made to bleed for some thoughtless word or deed. And we wonder why the tears when we try to do our best, but we'll understand it better by and by. By and by, when the morning comes, when the saints of God are gathered home, we will tell.
Same page 546, Love Lifted Me.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore, very deeply stained within, seeking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry, from the waters lifted me to save. To him I give, ever to him I cling, in his blessing. to Him belongs. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Souls in danger, look above. Jesus completely saves. He will lift you by His love out of the angry waves. He's the master of the sea. Billows His will obey. He, your Savior, wants to be saved today. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me.
All over my life.
I really hope and pray that you can say that this morning, that there's evidence in your life that that Jesus is a part of it. You know, we go in throughout the week, and we may be the only thing that points anybody to Jesus. I know, you know, you can work with a whole group of people that they may not know him. They might not hear anything about him except through you. So just sing with us. We're going to sing King of Glory. This morning, just thank you for being the King of Glory. Lord, thank you for just being the evidence in our life. Lord, I ask that you just touch us this morning. Just speak to us through your word. that you've given to Brother Mike. Lord, just be with anybody that wants to be here but is not able to be here this morning. Lord, bless this church. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Brother Ross, again. It is great to see you this morning. I'm glad to be here and grateful that this building is warm. Amen. In fact, Brother, this morning it was colder than a deacon's meeting talking about giving the pastor a raise. Now, if you know anything about Baptist church, that's pretty cold. Amen. Amen. But I appreciate Brother Reuben giving me this opportunity to be with you again today, and I do appreciate him and this great church. Thank God for all that the Lord is doing. And so once again, I'll just say hello to Brother Reuben and appreciate the opportunity to be here. And the Lord's already blessed us with the early service, and I'm glad to be back in this second service. Well, let me invite you to take your copy of the Word of God and turn to the book of Philippians chapter number 4. Philippians chapter 4. And as you turn there, also let me just say I appreciate Brother Reuben and you as a church for putting me up for today and the next couple of days as well, and then for taking care of my food. That's such a great blessing, and I thank you for that. So Philippians chapter 4, we're going to begin reading in verse number 10. And when you find that, if you can, won't you stand with us, if you would please, again, with your Bibles open or your devices turned on. Amen, as we give reverence to the reading of God's holy word. Philippians chapter 4, and we'll just begin reading in verse number 10. Philippians 4, verse 10. Notice the Apostle Paul writes and says, "But I rejoice in the Lord greatly that now at the last your care of me hath flourished again, wherein you were also careful, but you lacked opportunity. Not that I speak in respect of want, for I have learned, in whatsoever state I am, therewith to be content. I know both how to be abased, and I know how to abound. Everywhere and in all things I am instructed both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need." Now probably many of you were not familiar with those verses, but probably most of you here today, if not all of you, you're familiar, at least familiar, with that 13th verse. And so with your Bibles open, or you may know this verse from memory, would you just say this verse together with me out loud, Philippians 4:13, where Paul said, "I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me." Let's say it one more time together out loud. "I can do all things through Christ which strengthens me." Now for the next few moments, hopefully again the Lord being my helper in this service, I want to preach to you about this thought and this theme and this passage, and that is that Jesus is enough. Amen. That Jesus is enough. In fact, contrary to what Joel Osteen and other preachers, popular preachers, would say and what they preach, that you are enough. Folks, I want you to hear me this morning. You aren't. You aren't enough. I'm not enough. We aren't enough. But I guarantee you, Jesus is. Jesus is enough, and you may be seated. One of my favorite Christian songs in rather recent years has become a song entitled Enough, written by Elias Dummer. And the chorus says this, very simply, "Jesus, you are enough. Jesus, you are enough for me. With nothing, I still have everything. Jesus, you are enough for me." Now, I'm convinced this morning that that would have been the Apostle Paul's theme song if he had a theme song, because basically and simply that's what he's declaring in these verses. The bottom line of what we just read here in Philippians chapter 4, what Paul is saying is that Jesus is enough, that Jesus is sufficient, that Jesus is adequate. Now, this glorious truth that Jesus is enough involves at least three things. And they're right here in the passage. First of all, I want you to notice again This glorious truth that we see here, that Jesus is enough, involves, first of all, a lesson that is learned. A lesson that is learned. That's what we see again in verses 10 and 11. Now, one of the things you need to understand about this little letter that Paul wrote to the Philippians is that basically, even though he was inspired by the Holy Spirit to write this, he was writing to them, these fellow Philippian believers in Jesus. And basically what this little letter of Philippians is a thank you note that he wrote to them and sent to them by way of Epaphroditus, his co-laborer in Christ, thanking them for the financial gift that they gave to him. And that's exactly why he said in verse 10, "But I rejoice in the Lord greatly that now at the last your care of me hath flourished again," speaking primarily of their financial care of him. And then he went on and said, "Wherein you were also careful," speaking of their concern for him. But then he said, "But ye lacked opportunity." Now it's interesting to me that that phrase, "hath flourished," literally means is revived. That phrase where it said "has flourished again" means is revived. And sometimes we talk about and we sing about revival. We preach about revival oftentimes. But all revival is basically when the people of God begin to flourish again in the things of God. You know, sometimes when we're left to ourselves, you know, we begin to flounder in the things of God. But when the power of God and the presence of God, the Spirit of God begins to move in our hearts and lives again, we begin to, as Paul said here, we begin to flourish again in the things of God. And what's interesting is, in this context of what Paul, of which Paul is speaking, when real Bible revival comes, one of the areas that is affected is our giving. But now I want you to notice, lest they think that he was one of those evangelists who would pace the floor night and day, wringing his hands, and lest they think he was one of those evangelists who would go to the mailbox every day, to the post office box at the post office, to what we evangelists call the Wailing Wall. And if you want to know what that is, ask about the service, I'll tell you what that is. To see if any money was in the mail. He said, again in verse 11, "Not that I speak in respect of want, for I have learned in whatsoever state I am therewith to be content." And basically, here's what Paul was saying there. What he was saying is, now, I am appreciative for the gift you sent, but understand, I'm really not anxious about it. I'm not worried about it at all. Now, that word content that he used means to be satisfied and to be at peace with yourself. And I find this interesting. That word also means to be self-sufficient. But it is not a self-sufficiency that is within yourself. It means to be self-contained, not needing any outside assistance. And what's interesting is that that word content was used in that first century world to describe a country that was self-sufficient and that indeed was self-contained, that did not need any imports from other countries outside itself in order to survive. Now, I want you to notice that when he said stay, when he used that word stay, he was not talking about the geographical location that he was living in. Now, I know I don't have to explain this here in Louisiana, but in Texas, where I live, you have to explain that because there are some Texans who will say the reason they know that Paul was not a Texan is because no Texan in his right mind would ever say, "I'm content in whatever state I'm in." Amen. No, that word state there refers to the condition. It refers to the circumstance. It refers to the context of the situation that he was living in right then. But I want you to notice again that Paul says, now notice what he says in relationship to this contentment he's talking about. He says, "I have learned this." I have learned this. In other words, what he's saying is this contentment I'm talking about is something that's not automatic. This being content, or this being self-sufficient, self-contained, satisfied, or at peace in every state or circumstance or condition or situation in life is something that is learned, that you and I must learn. I mean, we're not born with this. This is not automatic. Now, I know when I said that, if this is something that's learned, that I lost a lot of you right there, because I realized this morning that one of the dirtiest words in the English language is this word learned. Amen. I mean, brother, if we got honest, we would have to admit that we don't want to learn anything. I mean, brother, we want everything now, if not sooner. And right now in the nation that we live in the day of the quick fix. I mean, we live in the day of instant credit and instant cash and instant coffee, and even nowadays, instant church. Amen. In fact, there is a church building not far from where we live in Rowlett, Texas, and it's had several churches meeting there. And I believe it was a church that was meeting in this building before the church that's meeting there right now. They had on their sign, this has been several years ago now, my wife and I were driving by it, and on that sign, they said they had an express service. They had an express, that's what it's called, an express service that began at 9 and ended at 9:30. And I told my wife, Debbie, I said, bless God, sometimes I can't get through the introduction of my message in 30 minutes, much less the entire service. Amen. Now, I know some of you are probably wondering, well, Brother Mike, when it comes to this contentment that Paul's talking about, I mean, couldn't right now God just kind of zap me with a holy zap and give me a good dose of this contentment right now? Well, I guess he could, because God is God. He can do anything he wants to, but I'm just telling you, one of the things I've learned is that's usually not the way he works. Or others of you, I can guarantee probably, maybe you're wondering, maybe you're thinking, well, Brother Mike, why don't we do this? Why don't we, when after you finish preaching, you give the invitation, and I come down there, and you pull a Benny Hinn on me, amen, and you pop me on the forehead, or you breathe on me, blow on me, and I pass out, and when I pass out and when I come to, I'll have this contentment. And let me just say, no, I can't do that. Well, on the hand, I guess I could do that. I mean, you could come down here this morning after I finish preaching, and after I give the invitation, you can come up to me, and I could breathe on you. And you probably would pass out, but I'm pretty much guaranteed, folks, it ain't going to be the Holy Ghost. It's going to be more like holy halitosis. Amen. But again, what I want you to see, that this contentment that Paul is talking about here, that we so desperately need here even today, is something that is learned. This truth that Jesus is enough involves a lesson that is learned. Or as Adrian Rogers said, in salvation, there's nothing to earn, but rather there is much to learn. But then this truth that Jesus is enough not only involves a lesson that is learned, but notice, second of all, that it involves a life that is lived. A life that is lived, and that's what we see in verse 12. Now, folks, I want you to hear me this morning. If we have truly been saved by the grace of God, if we're saved in that moment of true salvation experience, God, among other things, enrolled us in a school. I bet you didn't know that. But the moment, if you got saved, at the moment of true salvation experience, among other glorious things that God did in your life, my life, he enrolled us in a school, and that school is life. And this school of life has a curriculum which are all the experiences of everyday life. And I want you to notice that Paul says, I know. I know this. But now you need to understand that word does not just mean I know in the sense of intellectual knowledge of it, but rather it means I know in the sense of intimate, experiential, practical knowledge of it. In other words, what he's saying is, this contentment I'm talking to you about, I know this by personal experience. In fact, I know it by just living everyday life. Now notice when Paul says in verse 12, everywhere, and in all things I am instructed. He is referring to the school that God has us enrolled in as a child of the living God. And here's what Paul is saying. He is in everywhere I go. And everything, without exception, that happens to me, or just life, is a school in which God has sovereignly enrolled me. He is saying that the events of everyday life are my instructors. The things that happen to me every day, they are my instructors and my teachers that God uses in my life. In other words, folks, I want you to hear me this morning. Again, if you've been saved by the grace of God, and if you are a child of God, then understand that for the child of God, there is nothing. And brother, you can take that to the bank. There is nothing that happens to us that's incidental, coincidental, or accidental in our life. It is all providential, or it is a sovereign activity of God in our life. And folks, I want to tell you, I mean, even me being here this morning and preaching at this church is no accident. I mean, do you think it took God by surprise that Brother Reuben and his family came down with the flu? I mean, he already, as Brother David shared, we already had this schedule, and it just so happened, as luck would have it. No, folks, listen, don't ever talk about luck, because you know what luck is? That's the language of the heathen, brother. I want to tell you something, for the child of God, there's no such thing as luck. But it was in the providence of God. God knew. God knew. Brother Reuben and his family's going to be sick, and so he arranged for me to be here today. And what I'm trying to get you to, that's just one small illustration. That our life is not just a series of delightful activities or disastrous accidents. But rather, our life as a child of the living God is a series of divine appointments. And even our disappointments are His appointments. And so, folks, when you and I go through difficult days, we shouldn't just ask, and there's nothing wrong with asking these questions, but we shouldn't just ask, why is God doing this to me? Or why is God allowing this to happen to me? But what is God trying to teach me through this? And folks, I want you to hear me this morning, that situations for the Christians are not just events for you and I to go through, but rather they are events for you and I to grow through. And then I want you to notice that Paul not only identifies where the school is, but also what the studies are. Here's the curriculum of the school in which God has enrolled us. Notice what he said, to be abased and to abound, to be full and to be hungry, to abound and to suffer need. Now, evidently, what all come out of this, at least one thing, is that Paul was not one of those health and wealth prosperity preachers that said he was healthy and wealthy all the time. And folks, I want you to hear me this morning, that God has us enrolled in the school. And the curriculum and the study are all the things, there's no exception to this, are all the things, not just some of the things, or even most of the things, but all the things in life, every experience of life. And yes, I'm talking about the good things in life, and I'm even talking about the bad things in life, and I'm even talking about the ugly things of life that happen to us. And here's what Paul was saying. I've learned in this context, I've learned that when the offerings are coming in from the churches and I'm full, it doesn't add a thing to me. And folks, that's exactly why he said, in verse 11, not that I speak in respect of want. He's telling them, listen, I don't want you to misunderstand. I'm really not needy or wanting anything. Not that I speak in respect of want. And he goes on and says, in so many words, I've learned that when the offerings are not coming in and I'm empty and abased, it doesn't take anything from me. Paul said, here's what I've learned. I've learned that more possessions don't make me glad, and less possessions don't make me sad. Because what he's saying is, I'm learning this. I've learned how to be content. I've learned how to be self-contained. I've learned how to be independent of these external circumstances and situations of life, whether good or bad. Now, I know, I can just tell by the way some of you are looking at me, you think, well, yeah, that's easy for Paul to say that. I mean, after all, he's the Apostle Paul. He wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. And Brother Mike, furthermore, he didn't have it nearly as bad as I've got it. Well, let me just remind you of something, and this is interesting to me. These words we just read that we're studying this morning, you do understand that he didn't write these from a 5-star hotel somewhere on a comfortable bed between silken sheets with his head on a comfortable pillow. No, sir, these very words he wrote in a jail cell. For preaching the gospel. He wrote in a jail cell from a dungeon in Rome, waiting, as far as he knew, unless God intervened, to be tried and executed, to be tried before Nero and executed by Emperor Nero, who enjoyed taking Christians. And Nero, you study the history of Nero there in Rome, and you will find that he was a perverted king. And he hated Jesus, and he hated Christians, and he enjoyed capturing Christians, taking them, tying them to poles, covering them with tar, and then setting them on fire, and then using them as a light post for his gardens. It is a matter of historical documented fact that that's what he did. He hated Christians so much. So what that means is, folks, in that first century Christian, in that first century world, when they said somebody was on fire for Jesus, they meant it literally. They were literally on fire for the Lord. And basically, Paul said the same thing in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 8 through 10. And listen, if you can't identify with some of this, I mean, these extremes. And you know, our life, you know, just like last week, just a current illustration. I was preaching in San Angelo, Texas, West Texas. Brother, one day it was 11 degrees in the morning. I don't think he got out of the 20s or 30s that day. But on Wednesday or Thursday, the last day I was there, it was 75. Extremes. And a lot of times our lives are like that. Extremes. And that's what Paul said. By honor and dishonor. By evil report and good report. As deceivers and yet true. As unknown and yet well known. As dying and behold we live. As chastened and not killed. As sorrowful, yet always rejoicing. As poor, yet making many rich. As having nothing, and yet possessing all things. You know what Paul was saying? He said, you know, it's kind of like I'm a living corpse. It's like he was a spiritual zombie. He was saying it was like he was a wealthy pauper or a bankrupt millionaire. But what he's saying is that he learned the sufficiency of the Savior through all these extremes in life that you and I go through as well. And I don't know if you ever thought about this, but we Christians, and if you don't know this, I doubt very seriously if you're a true Christian. But we Christians are oftentimes walking, talking contradictions. We really are. In fact, the entire Christian life from start to finish is an unexplainable paradox. I mean, think with me about this. But the Bible says, as Christians, we die to live. We give in order to get. We lose to win. We fail to succeed. We deny ourselves in order to find ourselves. You know, I got to thinking about this some time back, and about what Paul was saying here in Philippians 4 and other places in the New Testament about his life. I said, and I began to think, don't you know that Paul must have been a thorn in the flesh of the devil? That he must have just aggravated and frustrated the devil to no end. And I began to think about this imaginary scenario. Maybe this happened, maybe there, I don't know if the Bible doesn't say this. But I was just kind of using some sanctified imagination. And perhaps one day the devil came to Paul and said, now, Paul, I want, said, son, have I got a deal for you? I tell you what, Paul, if you right now, here now, if you will reject Christ and if you will serve me and follow me for the rest of your life, then I will give you everything your little old heart could ever desire. And I believe, based on what we're seeing here in Philippians 4 and other places, that probably Paul would have responded to that offer something like this. Well, devil, thanks, but no thanks, because I already have everything. I have everything I need. And then the devil says, all right then, if you won't renounce Christ, and if you won't follow me and serve me, then I'll take everything from you. And I'm pretty sure that's how Paul would respond to that. He said, well, go ahead, because I don't have anything. Now, folks, let me ask you something. How do you beat somebody like that? How do you defeat somebody like that? Well, I want to tell you, you don't. You know, that's why I love the first chapter. I love this little letter, Philippians chapter 1, verse 21. You remember what he said there? Another popular verse. He said, for to me to live is Christ and to die is gain. You know what he's saying? And this kind of become one of my mottos. You know what he's saying? Hey, look, don't threaten me with heaven. I'm going to take you up on it. Amen. That's what he said. For me, well, what he's saying is this. While I'm alive, here's Jesus. He just doesn't give me life. He is my life. While I'm here in this world, it's Jesus. And when I die and I go there, it's Jesus there with heaven thrown in. Amen. What he was saying is, heads I win, tails I win. There's no way I can lose in this deal. And folks, here's one of the things that Paul learned, that you and I must learn, and that is everything associated with this world, we must learn to hold loosely. Because it's all so transitory, so temporary. So we can learn this truth that Jesus is enough by just living life. And the highs and lows of life, the ups and downs, the good times and the bad times, and the times we have more than enough and the times we have less than enough. In fact, God can bring us, and basically this is what Paul has said, where the Lord can bring us to the point where Job was, where we can say after Job lost his farm and his family, remember what he said when he got that report from those servants? They lost everything, including his kids. He said, The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Amen. Then finally, this truth that Jesus is enough involves not only a lesson that is learned and a life that is lived, but also notice it involves a Lord that loans or gives. And that's what we see in that 13th verse. Now that phrase, through Christ, which strengthens me, means through Christ who gives me strength. Now probably, again, most of you know this verse. And this verse is perhaps one of the most well-known, one of the most memorized, one of the most quoted verses in all the Bible. But also, I believe it's one of the most taken out of context and misapplied verses in the Bible as well. Because we've used, and I've heard people do this, we've used this phrase in Philippians 4:13, I can do all things, to mean I can do anything. Literally. In the sense of I can do everything I want to do. I can work any job, I can play any instrument, I can play any sport, I can move any mountain, I can perform any miracle, I can do anything and everything I want to do through Christ who gives me the strength to do it. But folks, what I want you to notice, that according to this context, that's not what Paul is saying at all. In this context, he is saying that we can, as a child of God, we can face and handle every circumstance of life through Christ who lives within us and gives us the power. You know what he is saying? He is saying, I am ready for anything and everything through Christ who gives me strength. So bring it on, whatever it is, good or bad. Here's what he's saying. Yes, I can be abased and I can abound. I can be full and I can be hungry. I can abound and I can have needs because I am content. I am independent of these external circumstances of life. I can face and handle any and every situation of life through Christ, through the Jesus who continually, who lives in me and continually loans or gives or infuses or pours strength and power in and through me. And that is the lesson that he learned that you and I must also learn as well. Years ago, down at Milldale, outside of Zachary, Louisiana, I heard Ron Dunn tell the true story of an old man in England who was very wealthy and had one son. That one son was a pilot in the military, but he was killed during World War II. Well, eventually that wealthy old man died as well, and since he had no heirs, his estate was to be auctioned off according to his will. Now, part of his vast estate was a fabulous art collection. And one of the auction houses in London undertook the task of auctioning off those paintings, many of which were masterpieces. So on the day of the auction, people gathered at the estate from all over the United Kingdom because they wanted the chance to buy some of those pieces in that great art collection. But as the auction started and began, the auctioneer came up and And he set up an easel, then he put a portrait on that easel. And the portrait, that painting on that easel, was a portrait, was a painting of that man's one son, whom nobody there, for the most part, knew. And most of the people thought it was absolutely worthless because not only did nobody know who that boy was, that son was, nobody knew the artist who painted it, so no one bid on it. But it just so happened in the audience that day, there was one of that old man's lifetime servants who knew and loved that son from the time he was born until the time he died. And this servant thought to himself, it would just be nice to have that portrait. And since nobody else is bidding, he could probably get it cheap, so he made a bid. Now, understand the auctioneer had already said that the man's will stated that before any of the other art pieces could be sold, the one of the son had to be sold first. And so since they wanted to get to the masterpieces, no one else made a bid, and since the servant was the only bid, though it was a low bid, he got it. And everybody was relieved because they're thinking, now we can get to the good stuff. But then the auctioneer got back up and said something that surprised everybody. He said, ladies and gentlemen, this auction is now over. And everyone was stunned. And then the auctioneer quickly explained that the man's will further stipulated that whoever got the portrait, whoever got the painting, whoever got the picture of the son, got it all. Brother, the entire estate. When did you hear what he said? He said, whoever gets the son gets it all. And folks, you do understand, according to the New Testament, that if we're saved, that in Christ, indeed, we are complete. In Him, we have been blessed. We have already been blessed with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places. In Him, in Jesus, we have been given all things that pertain to life and godliness. Folks, I want you to hear me this morning that God the Father has stipulated in His new will and covenant that we call the New Testament, that whoever gets His Son, the Lord Jesus, gets it all. That's why Paul said in Romans 8 that we were saved, we are joint heirs with Jesus, which simply means share and share alike. You know what that means? Whatever Jesus gets, I get, and you get. That's why I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. I don't know if you've caught on yet or not, but what I'm trying to tell you is that Jesus is enough. And He is enough for me. Now, folks, there's a lot of things I don't know. A lot of things I haven't learned yet, but here's one thing I've learned. In 50 plus years now of Christian living and Christian ministry, and that is that Jesus is enough. Jesus is enough when I want and when I don't. I mean, I've lived this. Jesus is enough when I want and when I don't. Jesus is enough when I'm abased and when I abound. Jesus is enough when I'm full and when I'm hungry. Jesus is enough when I have enough and when I don't. Jesus is enough in the good times and even in the bad times. Jesus is enough on the mountains and down there in the valleys. Jesus is enough in victory and even in defeat. Jesus is enough in sickness and in health. Jesus is enough when I succeed and even when I fail. Jesus is enough everywhere and in every situation of life. Jesus is enough, period. Case closed, end of the story. Folks, what I'm trying to get you to see this morning, that all we really need, we already have in the Lord Jesus. But, having said that, we won't really realize all we need, we already have in Jesus until Jesus is all we have. But when Jesus is all we have, we'll realize that He is all that we need. Amen. I believe we have a powerful illustration of this over in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 17. I Just this past week, when I was in San Angelo, I preached a message from Matthew 17 about the Mount of Transfiguration. I call it a preview of paradise. Amazing passage. I know you've read it, Matthew 17, where Jesus takes Peter, James, and John onto this mountain. Some believe it's Mount Hermon. And it says he was transfigured before them. And that's where the term Mount of Transfiguration. But what that means is when he's transfigured, they begin to have this vision of Jesus. They begin to see Jesus in a way they had never seen him. They begin to have this vision of Jesus in his unveiled deity. Because in that moment, the Bible says that he was transfigured before them, and his face began to shine as the sun, and even his clothing began to shine. And what happened was, in that moment, he, as it were, he pulled back the veil of his humanity so that they could see that beyond that flesh, he was also deity. That he wasn't merely just a good man, but that he was indeed the God man. He's fully God and fully man. And then if that were not enough, that vision of Jesus as an unveiled deity, these two visitors showed up. Remember who they were? Moses and Elijah showed up. They began talking with them. Now, here's what I found, just a little parenthesis right here. Here's what I find interesting is that Matthew 17, in his account of this Mount Transfiguration event, experience, just says that they began to talk with Jesus, but they don't say what they were talking to Jesus about. You have to go to Luke chapter 9. In Luke's version, in Luke's account, and you'll find the things I've just described for you, but Luke tells us exactly what Moses and Elijah talked to Jesus about. It says they talked to Jesus about his decease, his coming death, burial, resurrection, and ascension from Jerusalem. That's what they talked to him about. But here's what's interesting there. Luke chapter 9, I think verse 30 to verse 31, they began to talk with Jesus about his decease from Jerusalem. What's interesting is that word decease in the Greek text, you know, the New Testament was originally written in Greek. The Greek word translated as decease there, and just say if you can identify another word used in your Bible. But the Greek word translated as decease in Luke chapter 9 is the word exodon or exodus. So here's Moses and Elijah talking to Jesus about his coming exodus. Now, isn't that interesting? I love things like that. Here is Moses. Y'all remember Moses, right? Well, the first five books of the Bible. What's the second book of the Bible he wrote? Book of Exodus. So here's Moses, who God used in the original Exodus, talking to Jesus about his coming exodus out of this world. And then if that were not enough, not only did they have this vision of Jesus in this unveiled deity, and these two visitors, Moses and Elijah, talking about him, about his upcoming exodus out of this world. The Bible says that mountain was enveloped in a cloud, reminiscent of that glory cloud that enveloped Mount Sinai. Again, here's the connection to Moses, where he received the Ten Commandments. Y'all remember this? The Jewish scholars refer to this as the Shekinah, the visible glory of God enveloped that mountain. And then the voice of God the Father spoke from that cloud and said, this, referred to Jesus, put the spotlight on Jesus. This is my beloved Son. Hear ye him. Listen to him. The Bible says, when Peter, James, John saw all this, brother, they fell on their face. They were scared to death. But then the Bible says that vision of Jesus in his unveiled deity vanished. He pulled back the veil of his flesh. Though he was still fully God and fully man, all they saw now was the man. And those visitors, Moses and Elijah, they went back home to heaven. And the voice of God was silent. And the Bible says when Jesus, they're on their face, scared to death, Jesus comes and he touches them. And when they got up and looked around, it says they saw no one save Jesus only. They saw no one save Jesus only. And the next verse, I believe verse 9 says, and as they came down from the mountain. Did y'all catch the significance of that? Yeah, Peter, James, John came down from that mountain, but Jesus came down with them. See, they still had Jesus. And Jesus was sufficient. Jesus was adequate. Jesus was enough. Amen? Folks, I'm telling you, this Bible, even from Genesis to Revelation, is telling you and I that you need Jesus. When you got him, he's enough. Amen. Let's stand together if we could. Just bow our heads and close our eyes. Every head bowed, every eye closed. The heads bowed, eyes closed.